And we are back. Welcome back to the King's Report. This morning, Monday, November 20th, 2017. Saying King Report live from the Chunhyugung Studios. To all the kings and queens of the Kingdom of God, we are now joined with Pastor Joshua Mitchell, who is the founder and overseer of Kingdom Fellowship Ministries International since 1986. And the name was changed to Kingdom Embassy International Center in 2012. He's also founded Kingdom Ambassadors University since 2004, Council of Apostles International since 2004, and senior pastor of King's Temple Center in Humble 2003, and First Church of Pasadena 2014. He's been in ministry for 29 years, received his Bachelor of Arts in Biblical Studies in 1988, his Master's of Divinity in 2008, and received his Doctor of Philosophy in the year of 2009. He's married to his wonderful wife, Prophetess Kobe Mitchell, and today together they parent three beautiful girls. God has given him the biblical mandate as an apostle, of Ephesians 4:11 through 15, and to fill the office of apostleship based on 1 Corinthians 12:28. He's dedicated to the restoration of the Church of Jesus Christ and the development of the Kingdom of God's blueprint for the 21st century leaders. Pastor Mitchell, thank you so much for joining us this morning, even though it's taped on Sunday night.
Amen. Well, praise God. I am excited about the opportunity to be able to be here and talk and dialogue with you about the things that's concerning the heart of God.
Well, praise God. Thank you so much for joining us. We know you're a very busy man. I see you also have ministries providing apostolic covering, mentoring for churches throughout the U.S., Haiti, Africa, India, and the Philippines, worldwide. And of course, your Kingdom Broadcasting Network is a 24-hour Christian broadcasting network, the first Black-owned, African-American-owned Christian broadcasting network in the state of Texas.
Yes, sir. That is correct. The state of Texas and the state of Louisiana. Yes, sir.
Amazing. Praise God. You know, during the break, we talk about it. Why did you name your ministries, and how come all your ministries and your the work that you're doing seem to have the name, the word kingdom in there? Why is that such an important focal word for the Christian person?
Well, it's all about the kingdom of God. We are, you know, once we give our heart to the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of our life, that gives us the rights as citizens to be in the king, in his kingdom. So I consider those of us that's part of the body of Christ as citizens in the kingdom of God, which is what I have discovered throughout studying the word of God.
It's amazing. You know, a lot of people talk about the gospel, and a lot of, and even just in terms of you secular people, think they know what it means to about the gospel. Right. But it's interesting when you look at the actual scripture and how Jesus himself defined what the gospel was. I have a whole list of what I call kingdom gospel verses. We did a whole series on this. But whenever Jesus describes the gospel, which he is bringing to the world, he always refers to it. Here it is, Matthew 6:9. Of course, this is the Lord's Prayer where he said, pray every day, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, the kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, etc. Also, Matthew 6:33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Matthew 7:21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Matthew 10:7. As you go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Luke 4:43. Yes. He said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent. He's a sent to preach the kingdom of God. Matthew 4:23, Jesus went about all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. Mark 1:14, now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand.
Yes.
Repent and believe the gospel. Matthew 9:35. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom.
Yes.
Matthew 24:14. The gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for the witness of to all nations, and then shall the end come. Matthew 25:34. Then shall the king say unto them, on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you the foundation of the world. You know, it's interesting because when you ask a normal person, what is the gospel? They're usually going to say, well, it's the gospel of, you know, Christ, or it's the gospel, something about the birth, death, and resurrection of a person named Jesus, etc. But when you look at how Jesus described it, he described his gospel as a gospel of the kingdom of God. What does that put it? What does that put in your heart and mind this morning, Pastor?
Well, when you think about, well, first of all, let me first say this first. Thank you for reading all of those scriptures concerning the kingdom of God. Jesus, when he walked the earth, his whole message was about the kingdom. It was about the Father's kingdom. The word kingdom itself in the Greek means rule of God in your life. That's what the word kingdom itself means. It's the rule of God. So as he's preaching all these different times, he's talking about the kingdom. He's really talking about the rule of God in your life. God have first precedence in your life. He's the only one that should be the first in your life, and not him and some other thing or whatever the case may be. In my now 30 years in ministry, I just actually celebrated 30 years in September. Wow. So now 30 years in ministry, I have come to not only learn and still learning, but appreciate all that the kingdom of God is about. And when we understand first and foremost, it is about the rule of God in your life. And from that point on, if he have that rule in our heart, in our life, then that's nothing that's going to be withheld from us. Because as you know, in a kingdom, the king takes care of all of his subjects, right? And so if you are obeying God the way that he asks us to and laying it out in his word, then that's nothing that he will withhold from us. So I'm excited about having the knowledge and the understanding of what the kingdom of God is really all about. You asked the question, why kingdom is put on everything that God has given me to do? It is because he rules it. He is the ruler. He's the ruler of my life. I like to put it like this. If you read further in the bio, or maybe on my homepage on our television network, on the link that says about us, what I have on there, what I said is that Father God is the owner, and I'm the co-owner. He owns it. But he allowed me to co-own with him, right? And so because he owns it, and he's given me the wisdom and the know-how how to do it.
I like that.
And so forth. So he's looking for us, that he's given us to do ministry concerning him, to do our part. And so that's what we've been trying to do for 10 years. We also, November the 14th, just celebrated 10 years of broadcasting as well.
Wow, God is amazing. What can I say? God is so good.
Yes.
Now, you know, when we talk about the kingdom, we are usually, obviously, there's a king in the kingdom, right?
That's right.
And when we think about it in the modern day, we're usually raised up to believe that kingdoms are bad, or that even Christians should not, they should feel that democracy or any state of, you know, government that we have today, you know, should be the way it should be in the kingdom.
Right.
So in the modern day, you have many Christians that talk about the kingdom, but they forget that in the kingdom, there's a center. It's like a solar system has the sun at the center. In a kingdom, everything revolves around the sun.
That's right. That's exactly right. It's amazing that you use that analogy, because Jesus Christ is the center of the kingdom of God. And if we have Christ, if we have received him as Savior and Lord in our life, then that means he's the center of our life. We're going to operate now from a different perspective. We're going to have a different perspective, a different mindset, and a different instructions and rules now that's going to govern our life prior to giving our heart to him. Prior to that, you know, we live like the devil. We did whatever we wanted to do, you know, just cut up real bad. But once we give our heart to the Lord, and he becomes the center of our life. And then now we follow the set guidelines and prescription that's laid out to us in his word. And I'm telling you, it's the best life. It is the best life in the earth realm, period, bar none. Amen. Serving the king, being obedient to the king, being in the kingdom because of the king is the best life ever. I love it.
Amen. You know, it's so amazing. God said, Christ said that we would become co-heirs with Christ.
That's right.
And that the saints would rule with a rod of iron in the kingdom.
Right.
Now, we're so used to being beat down. We're so used to being controlled. We're so used to worshiping Hollywood, Silicon Valley, you know, the state, whatever it may be. We're so used to being underneath the authority of this secular world, or right. in many other countries, in false kingdoms and satanic kingdoms, or in quote modern societies, you know, political Satanism has tremendous grasp over the nations, where they create a system where which actual Satanism can thrive. For example, we have a system in the West that is murdering 54 million plus babies.
Yes.
So since 1970, what is it, three? I mean, incredible. Yeah. You have all this thing that God warned us not to do, you know, with the Baal worship, where they were sacrificing little children to the fires of Baal, and you know, offering these to the pagan gods. We had Zachary King on, and he's a 26-year Satanist high priest.
Wow.
Who's now given his life to Christ.
Wow. Awesome.
Not only targets blacks, and Margaret Singer was a total racist. She said she wanted to eradicate blacks, but that the Satanists and the Wiccans and the Luciferians gather at the Planned Parenthood sites, and they do black masses. They get access to the fetuses because they need to do a blood ritual, a sacrifice, and they want the human because Satan gets power and loves when they kill babies or they do the rituals with babies. He was exposing that fact that Planned Parenthood is not just, you know, women's health services. It is literally where a church of Satan is happening.
Wow.
You know, we have a system that's protecting that. And it's like, it's creating the place where actual Satanism can thrive in our country.
Yes.
You know, you guys dealt with in Houston, you had a lesbian mayor who was forcing you to use, you know, your daughter, you know, all of a sudden could have some guy walk into the restroom with her. I mean, this was unbelievable. This talk about a place where Satanists can thrive, or Satan's people and spirits can thrive.
Right. Well, you know, we still dealing with that issue. As we are talking about this now, we're still fighting that issue, actually. We're still going to court and all that. Even though we have a new mayor, he just picked up where the old mayor left off at because of the best interest groups of people. You know, it's about money. It's about those who's pushing money behind this agenda and so forth to get this passed, you know, for the LGTB, whatever they call themselves, that whole homosexual group, you know.
They're adding new troubles every day.
Yeah, it's just amazing. You know, going back to that whole ordeal, when the mayor tried to subpoena the messages, the preaching messages, from certain pastors who were speaking out against this. And so I'm a part of an organization called the Houston Area Pastors Council. And that council has been developed since 2003 for the purpose of dealing with these kind of issues from all kinds of governments, from dealing with secular government. We're talking about the city government, state government, county government, and federal government as well. So we took this thing to them because she tried to subpoena this. So we weren't going to take it sitting down, and she thought we was. But God has put some Christian attorneys that has pro bono taken this case, and we've won by the grace of God.
Wow.
We've won this situation, the first round. All right. But we're still dealing with it now. Now it's gone to the state of Texas. It's at the state capitol now. And so we're having to continue to pray, fast and pray, that this thing will never make it past where it's at now and become law.
Now, yes. Just to refresh our memories, this was remind us of what the subpoenas were, number one, and of course, what the mayor was trying to get past with the bathroom situation and all that, just to refresh our memory for those who don't know the situation.
Well, let me back up. First of all, that particular mayor, when she first ran for the mayoral office, she was telling the public she wasn't running just because she was gay or she was homosexual. Well, in fact, she was running on that ticket, but she did it in such a way that most of Houstonians didn't pick up on it and catch it. All right. So she won the first term. And then it was during that first term, we started dealing with an issue, first and foremost, with a law that they was trying to tax the church on, with the church's tax exempt, but they was trying to tax the church on in terms of water that's running off your roofs onto your property. They wanted to tax the church on that first. That's the first thing that she came out with. They had passed this law. Oh yeah, this is a city ordinance and law that they was trying to pass for all of Houstonians. So then they thought that they could find a way to tax the church. Well, that didn't go too well for them. So they lost on that deal. So then when she ran the second term, she really came out of the box, out of the closet, if you will, to let people know, especially in the homosexual lifestyle, I'm running for you. I'm running for you. So she made it absolutely clear. All right. So now
she had a target on all the Christian churches.
Exactly. Exactly. So she put into a situation of a young man that thought he was a girl. A young man who thought he was a girl, so that he could use the women's or the girls' restroom. So that's how it first got started. We took that situation and we fought that situation. And so it really kind of metastasized. It got bigger into it just being all the city properties. They was trying to push all the public city properties, parks and all that. If you are a male that feel like you're a woman, you can go and use the woman's restroom.
But why are you Christian pastors so intolerant? Don't you know there's no such thing as biology and anybody can choose their gender if they feel like it? Be a girl today, be a boy tomorrow. Oh my goodness.
So what ended up happening is that we weren't going to take this sitting down because it was going to affect our little girls in the public arena. All right. And so that's where it all started at. So then we start speaking out. Preachers start speaking out over their pulpits, doing radio interviews and so forth as a result of this situation. And it got back to the mayor's office. And she thought that, that she was going to try to sue the many pastors to subpoena their messages on tapes or whatever, Facebook, whatever it was, YouTube, television, whatever it was. But what she didn't know is that we weren't going to take that sin down either, because number one, we have the law on our side with the Second Amendment. That's number one. You can't. Yes. Second Amendment. Number two, you cannot by law come into a religious facility or any religious association and demand or subpoena something that is covered under the Second Amendment. So now the fight gets very ugly from that point on. It got real, real ugly from that point.
I'm just curious, just so that she's, just to make put on the record.
After, for example, Muslim mosques and try to subpoena Muslims?
No, she did not.
Oh, so this is, of course, this is the tolerant left. This is the tolerant LGBTQ. This is the tolerant, open-minded, liberal, academics and mayors that are going after the intolerant Christians because they want to stand up for gay rights, but they won't say anything about Islam.
I mean, we disagree with you being a homosexual and having a homosexual life. That's an abomination before God. But we're not going to throw you off a dang roof. We're not going to try to implement Sharia law where you can allow allow sex slavery and have sex marriage with a 5-year-old daughter, and that's what Muhammad had. He had a 5-year-old wife.
I mean, this is so hilarious how the LGBTQSS, whatever they're called now, they're always going after the Christians. Their arch enemy is Christianity.
Right.
They
right.
never touch Islam. How, Pastor, how do you talk to us? How do you decipher this? How can the LGBTQ ally with radical Islam try to protect them all the time, never go after them, never try to bring up any of their humongous crimes against women, misogyny, sex slave, Islam, there's a trans-Saharan slave trade I talk about today, has put into slavery over 150 million Africans, Africans, two-thirds of which were women right. over, you know, total
million women of not only Africa, 150 out of Africa, 50 million out of other countries. You're talking about 132 million women who were sold into sex slavery, sexual exploitation, and in the West, nobody talks about it. But they want to go after a Christian pastor because he doesn't want some, you know, freak to use a bathroom with his daughter. Give me a break.
Well, at the end of the day, when you look at what you are talking about, all the different religion is after and trying to silence the mouth of anybody who believe and serve the true and living God. That's the bottom line. It doesn't matter who it is. That's the bottom line. So the city, the state, the county, the feds, or whatever, they are not going to go after these other religions because they are no threat. Those who worship and serve the true and the living God, we are a threat to Satan's agenda, because all this really falls back under Satan's agenda, really. What he's trying to do is just kill off all the Christians as he can. And if he can't do that, just try to beat them down so much so to where we just quit and give up. Well, if you truly are born again, if you truly love God, you are not going to quit and give up. As a matter of fact, you're going to have more tenacity to want to fight even more. And that's what's going on. There's been a surge here in the state of Texas of people who have come out of the homosexual lifestyle, have given their life to Christ. Wow. And now they're on the right side, which is God's side, fighting against the very lifestyle that they used to be in. So they are speaking out against where they once was. And many people, so it doesn't matter how much they try to persecute believers in Christ Jesus or do whatever they're doing, it only makes the church stronger. And we in the church, if we can get this and see this, we would want to join in and make that so strong to even the weakest link in the body of Christ is strong. And that's where we got to get to. Amen.
You know, what's it? Christians now are the world's most persecuted religious body. Over 200,000 Christians have been massacred in Syria. The UN did nothing about it. They never even addressed it. They never even talked about crimes against humanity. Right, nobody, right. Liberal, the left side. I mean, they had, during President Obama's reign, they literally had pictures of him as a Jesus figure. And they wanted, if you were black, if you were a minority, you had to support him. If you didn't support him, you were racist. Right. They put it all about race. And it was not about race. It's about whether or not this person is doing a socialist thing, trying to destroy the country and I'll target Christianity or not. We have a country where which we are based on biblical values. We used to have the Ten Commandments in the homes, in the public offices, right. In front of state buildings, you know, all this stuff.
But you can work an evangelical, you know, LGBTQ group in your middle and high school and recruit children to become gay. I mean, what the heck is this?
Yep, that's right. That's right. And then with all of our curriculum here in the United States, especially the state of Texas, there's been a shifting of the textbooks now. Most of your textbooks now are geared toward this alternative lifestyle. So in other words, what they're trying to do, and they're trying to be successful in doing it, and they will be if we don't do something about it. What they're trying to do is push out the marriages by which God had created, one man, one woman.
Oh, yeah.
Not two men and not two women. And so they're trying to push that out completely by pushing this same-sex marriage stuff, which Obama made law before he left office and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, and so we have to look at all what's going on here as the people of God and do what we need to do as his people to not settle for this stuff, not to allow this to just be what it is and we don't do anything about it. And that's the issue that I see among many of the people of God, is that we become too passive. First of all, we become passive over the things that that is concerning the heart of God. Marriage is number one. It is the institution by which God created. Yes. He created that. And so for believers in Christ Jesus to be passive in this area and say, oh, just leave it alone. You know, they got to be happy too. No, they don't. That's not happiness. That's misery.
That's abomination.
That's right. It's not only abomination. I mean, it's downright, it's a death trap.
Yes.
If you look at the, if you go and start interviewing many of these people that came out of the same-sex marriage or the lifestyle, you know, homosexual lifestyle, those that are in it now, if you can pull them to the side and really just have a heart-to-heart talk with them, they are some of the most miserable people. They're miserable. They have no happiness at all, no peace at all, because the devil's going to wear you out. He ain't going to let you have no peace. He got you now, so he's going to wear you out and ultimately try to kill you.
You made such an important point. The devil is after. We fight not against flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, rulers, right, dark places, you know? And spiritual wickedness in high places. And so we're talking about fighting a spiritual, evil, satanic king.
Ammon animates these people who don't even know, but they may be possessed with a devil or a demon. They may be doing the will of that demon without them even recognizing why they're having all this lust of flesh, why they're having all this same-sex attraction. And isn't it interesting how they started with the homosexual agenda? You know, they said it was, oh, it was a disease. It's biological. They don't have a choice. You have to be compassionate to people who have disease, right? And then they did it with the transgender. Oh, this is biological. It's a disease. Have compassion for somebody who's sick. And now they were trying to push minor attraction syndrome, which is pedophilia, people raping girls, little babies and boys, saying that, oh, that's a disease. CNN wrote a piece, pedophilia, not a crime, a disease. They're pushing the same thing, more deviant sexuality, but they're pushing the same technique.
Right. So then just look at what Canada recently did. You know, Canada has passed laws for not only for homosexuality, but now for all of this bestiality and this pedophilia. And after a while, we're going to have the same thing, because we tend to follow where other countries are at. You know, you look at different countries worldwide. And of course, you know, you know quite a bit, because you are originally from Korea, right?
That's,
and things. So you know a lot that is going on and things and so forth. But here in our country, we're following some of the same footsteps as Canada has passed these laws, and they recently just passed one about less than a month or so ago. I believe it's about pedophilia. They can go and enjoy it. They can do whatever. They're not going to get stopped. They want any of that. I'm telling you. So what's going to come next? What's going to come next is watch this. Not only same-sex marriage, they already passed a law in Canada where you can marry your animal, right? Okay, so they got that law passed. This is coming to America. The next thing they're going to, this thing is getting so crazy. So having multiple wives, where it used to be frowned upon in Utah, it will no longer become such a thing that people frown upon anymore. Being a polygamy, right? Having multiple wives and all this kind of stuff. It's going to be a law passed here too, eventually.
Yeah, that's it. That's in Sharia law. You can have up to four wives,
unlimited divorce. And in Sharia law, you can have sex slaves. I mean, so this is just incredible. You know, you're talking about even Canada, bestiality, all this kind of thing. It's absolutely incredible. We had Jesse Lee Peterson, you know, on the other day, and he was mentioning the fact, I mean, Reverend Peterson out there, he's in California out there, and he's really fighting for the black man. Because as an African-American who lived under, you know, the Jim Crow laws and on a plantation, he's talking about, look, Satan has attacked the black man because the devil is always going to go after the husband. He's going to go after those Christian alpha males because he's got to get rid of them to get the woman, to get Eve. And once he gets Eve, he got the children. So he's going to try to get in and destroy the man, the Christian alpha male. And we know, we were talking about how, for example, in the black community before the 1960s, you had a huge retention rate of fathers in the home. You had up over 80% of the black homes had a father in the home. And they would teach their sons discipline. They would teach them how to shoot. The NRA, for example, helped arm black folks so they could fight against the Ku Klux Klan. Even though the Democratic Party always says the NRA is the racist ones, they were the ones who were arming blacks so that the KKK can get them. And so you had this situation where, you know, black men, Christian black men were training their children, their sons, to be disciplined, you know, to work hard, to love Christ, to love your neighbor, you know, and you had the father in the home. Now, after Lyndon B. Johnson said that he wanted to put, you know, the black community onto, because they're going to do uppity, he wanted to give them little but not enough to make a difference and have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years. That was his plan. And he did it by saying, okay, we'll give you support, you know, to the black community, but you first have to divorce your husband. Get rid of your man. Then you'll get the paycheck from Big Daddy government. And, of course, look at what happened. Now you have only 30% of, you know, homes have African-American homes have a father in a home. Now, this is not only with the black community. They've done it to the Latinos. They're going after the Southeast Asians and the different minorities. This is how they keep us under control.
Yeah, that's right. That's absolutely right. You know, when you, you bring up a lot of points. So let's go back to this kingdom thing, because Satan is the god of this world. The Bible's clear on that, right? Satan's kingdom is here in the earth realm right now. He's ruling the world. So everything that we're talking about now falls up under the rulership of Satan in his kingdom here, this worldly system. Yes. When we get saved and we come up under the rulership of Jesus Christ, God the Father, now that brings about a complete different kind of kingdom. In the kingdom of God, there is no murder of any kind, none whatsoever. In the kingdom of God, if you follow the prescriptions written down in the word of God, you can have a successful marriage, a successful life. One man, one woman, bearing children, right? Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth, right? But the devil, under his kingdom, that's right. Under Satan's kingdom, let's disrupt that. Let's kill off the babies. Let's kill off, let's cause abortion to take place. And we kill off, 50 some million or 1,000 a day or whatever the numbers. I used to know what they were.
That's right, 54 million over the last, since 1973. And you're talking about over 50%.
That's right.
Of abortions are targeted on black neighborhoods.
Black neighborhoods and Latino neighborhoods, because Planned Parenthood has the second largest facility in the world here in Houston. It is the first largest here in the continental United States. The first largest here, right here in Houston. And that's another reason why the mayor was mad too, because we were protesting and marching and praying against this thing. And a lot of stuff came out in terms of what they were doing really behind closed doors with the fetuses and all these kinds of, as you talked about early on, a lot of stuff is being done on the black market and things of that nature.
Oh, goodness. But see, did you see those videos where they're selling them? They're selling the fetuses, you see that?
Yeah, I see it.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
That was incredible.
Yeah, yes, it was. So when you look at the kingdom of Satan versus the kingdom of God, which kingdom would you rather live in?
That's right.
You know, I want the kingdom of God any day, because in the kingdom of God, I don't care what Satan is doing in his kingdom. I'm protected because I'm in the kingdom of God. And as the word of God tells me, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every word spoken against me, I condemn it, right? And so, hey, It's awesome. It's wonderful to be in this time space continuum in God's kingdom right now. I love it. I love where I'm at in my life. I'm telling you, I love it.
Amen. You know, now we have, of course, President Trump in. And of course, he's been trying to do his best. He just got back from Asia, trying to help, for example, Korea. The whole Korea situation is just ridiculous. And you got the crazy man in the North literally putting the world in you know,
anxiety. Because of the fact that they got nukes and they're doing hydrogen test bombing and, you know, blowing things up. And of course, you have South Koreans who have become totally brain dead to the fact of how dangerous they're dealing with, you know, a lunatic up there. But when we were in Korea, for example, we were working with the Defense Department and, you know, our father was instructing them very closely, saying, look, South Korea, you got to be stronger. The South Korean military is completely unprepared. You're in a situation where the North can invade any time. China now has aircraft carriers that are larger and more powerful than the U.S. They're building a military, spending more in terms of percent of GDP on their military than any country in the world. If you do the if you do a purchasing parity analysis, and you have a situation where this is not a Judeo-Christian culture. The Chinese culture is not a Judeo-Christian culture. They don't abide by the same rules. It's not about good and evil. It's about whether they win or lose. That's all that matters. It doesn't matter whether or not it's good or it's moral to do something or not. And that's, of course, I'm speaking generally because in China, for example, the evangelical church and the body of Christ is the fastest growing religion in China, even though you'll be killed if you are a believer, you know, and not of the state. And, you know, we were telling the Korean, government that, look, Korea has to be ready because you have to be more like Israel or you got to be like Switzerland. You got to have a military. Everybody has to go to the military service anyway. So might as well let them bring their firearms back to their home. So just in case the North or China attacks, you have the civilian population can become an army in 1 second. You don't have to wait 3, 4, 5, 8 hours, 20 hours, 24 hours, 48 hours to get everybody to a state where in which they can, you know, fight against these oppressors. And we're talking about, you know, how important it is for to get past the UN and political correctness, talking about we have to all be disarmed. When you're disarmed, you become prey to dangerous predators. And that's why, of course, we were telling Korea, look at the model of Israel. Look at the model of Switzerland. You know, look at how dangerous. You have a nuclear power with a crazies up at the top, right above you, and at any time they can attack Seoul or East Asia or wreak havoc on the world. And, you know, how are you going to be able to survive this? You have to be able to be, of course, in the will of God, but you also have to be in the hedge of protection of God, and you have to have your own 5% responsibility where you are, as a nation, prepared. Right? Sometimes God will send a healer. Sometimes God will send a miracle. But sometimes God will send a doctor or a helicopter to save you.
That's right.
Yeah. And so, you know, we were telling them. Now Trump has just got back from Korea. All our people in Asia, sanctuary, brothers and sisters
in Japan. And he is just trying. He's just trying to say, "Look, I want the normal person to be able to, you know, be successful, to worship God." He's saying we got to say Merry Christmas again. Christians got to stop being persecuted, you know. But you have a whole situation where you got the whole deep state going after him and just trying to unravel everything that he's trying to do. He's trying to bring power back to the people. He's trying to bring power back to you know, the normal Joe. But you got this whole Washington apparatus trying to cover up their pedophile scandals. They're trying to cover up their Harvey Weinstein, you know, having 6 and 4, 8-year-old boys in the bathtub, and Hillary Clinton going to Marina Abramovich Satanist rituals and all hiding that. Now that's coming out. All these elites into pedophilia, all these Hollywood elites into groping women and assaulting women and children and boy raping young boys. I mean, goodness. This is all coming out, you know, all the elites, what they're into, the Satanism that they're into, the child sex, you know, rituals they're into. You're talking about it. This is Satan's kingdom. What is your assessment of President Trump right now? Is he doing a good job? Is he doing the best he can do? What do you feel about President Trump?
Well, that's a very important question, really, because I really haven't studied him enough to know. I've been so involved in what I'm doing in television, and pushing the gospel out worldwide, and things like that. I really have not really done a lot of study, and I'm a researcher. I do a lot of researching. I research presidents from Trump all the way back to 1913, back in the 1800s since Lincoln. But I really have not just really had the time to really just kind of research. You know, I can go off what I hear, certain news. I don't pay attention to the secular news media anymore. I watch some certain Christian news media or listen to certain Christian news media on radio and so forth to get most of my news when it comes to anything that's going on with the president or the White House or the Senate or anything, because the secular news is biased. To me, they are controlled. They are only going to give to the general public what they're told to give. That's control. So I don't buy what they say. So for me right now, I'm still really trying to get to a place to where I can just stop and spend some time and see who President Trump really is. You know what I'm saying? So that's where I'm at. Right?
He's trying to help pastors. He's trying to get rid of the Johnson Act, which basically allows federal government through the power of the 501c3 to threaten pastors if they speak out against, you know, political opponents. It doesn't allow them to promote, for example, a conservative versus a liberal, because the pastor says, hey, this liberal is going to do LGBTQ stuff. He's going to allow transgender bathrooms. He's going to, you know, they're pushing for minor attraction syndrome. That's against Christianity. That's against, and as a pastor, I'm going to speak out against that. You couldn't do that under the Johnson Act because was, quote, separation of church and state. But
yeah,
Trump is going to go after that and try to get rid of that.
Right, right. Well, number one, it should have been done away with from the time it started.
This is how
the devil was able to get in and infiltrate into the body of Christ by using Johnson to create an act to control the preachers from having a voice speaking out against them. And so by offering a 501c3, you know, for your church, you're going to get these tax breaks and all this kind of stuff. Forget all that. If that's going to bind my hand from preaching against you, if that's going to bind me from really preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, I don't need that, you know? So I say, forget it. I mean, it should have been dealt with at the time Johnson brought it into law. You know, when the government brought it into law as he wrote it, they should have dealt with that back then. Now you want to deal with that because a lot of preachers are starting to understand that we never really needed this. You know, if this is going to stop us from really speaking out, speaking the word of God, number one, against what you're doing that is against God, oh no, we don't need this. So let me tell you what's happening in the state of Texas. I can speak more specifically in the city of Houston, in the greater Houston area. What's going on is that many churches are doing away with their 501c3 status because they realize that they didn't need it anyway.
That's right.
Really, all it does is really kind of give you a little perks, but that's control. I mean, the church has been under this control of this system ever since it's been enacted. But now many of them are getting from underneath all that altogether. They are taking their churches out of the 501c3 status, and they may create a CDC, which is a community development, something like that, that's totally separate from the church. If you want to do some community work and you want see, I'm very leery about the government anyway. I guess because I know too much. I'm very leery about
the government. It's the
right, because my father always talk about it as, you know, the archangel. It's the it tempts Eve, and it goes after the woman. If she can get rid of her man, and then she signs on to go with Lucifer, he'll give her little treats. But as she does that, her life will be destroyed, her children's life will be destroyed, her marriage life will be destroyed, her spiritual life will be destroyed. And then, of course, he takes control of the, as you said, of the churches through the 501c3, and then, you know, it just becomes this this game that Satan is playing of control over the people, so that people cannot actually be step into their kingdom, queendom mentality with Christ as the King of Kings, standing with him as co-heirs with Christ with a rod of iron to stand against Satan's kingdoms. And they become weak. They become weak, and the population becomes, not able to fight back or even speak out against the trespasses on which the government is doing.
Yeah, there's a lot of churches here, really, a lot of pastors are really waking up to a lot of what we're talking about now, which is a great thing. You know, they are waking up and bringing their church out of this submission to this worldly king and his kingdom. That's what it is. You submitted, and you are forced to be submitted on top of that of this law, you know, or anything that is trying to come against that which we believe in, that's coming from the kingdom of God and his word, such as this bathroom issue. You know, like I said, we're still fighting this thing. And I trust eventually at the state of Texas, because we have a governor that is a believer. We have a lieutenant governor that's a believer. We have many in the state Senate are believers. I've met many of these people, and they are believers, and they are fighting for the rights of what the scripture says. They're fighting for the rights of our daughters and wives that are having to go into the restroom and they see a man in there, you know, because he felt like today that he was a female and he can go in there. Oh yeah. I mean, they got some ridiculous laws that a man can just feel like a female and can go into the ladies' restroom. Oh yeah, that's what they're trying to pass.
Oh my goodness.
Well, you know what they're trying to do in the public school? They're saying in a public school, if the boy feels like he's a girl, right? Yep. He doesn't even have to get a doctor's note. He can use the female locker rooms and bathe naked with the girls.
That's right.
What
that's
the hell are they talking about? They're smoking something. This is ridiculous. How many boys are saying, I'm a girl today?
Yeah. Well, it's just looking at this from both kingdom perspective, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Satan. Jesus put it like this: a kingdom that is divided against itself cannot stand, right? We know the kingdom of God is never going to be divided, even though we have some people in God's kingdom that might not be living right. But the kingdom of Satan, oh my goodness, man, they'll turn on each other in a heartbeat. They'll kill each other in a heartbeat. That is a kingdom that is divided, and they will not stand. Bless the name of the Lord. They will not stand. So I'm telling you, we're at a pivotal point in this country and worldwide, and it boils down to two kingdoms, kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world. Which kingdom are you really living in? That's what it really boils down to. Wow. At the end of the day, which kingdom are you living in?
That's right. Yes, in the end, it comes down, it's a battle between two kingdoms, battle between two lineages, battle between the real blood of Christ and those who've taken Satan's blood.
That's right.
What a tremendous word. Pastor Mitchell, thank you so much for joining us today. I can't believe how fast an hour goes by, but it's now come to the end of our broadcast. I know you got to get running. We're so grateful to have you on. Love to have you on again and talk about all these kingdom things. Boy, it is such an important topic. My goodness, for the body of Christ to be start talking about the kingdom and get kingdom-centered, kingdom-crazy, and preach the gospel. That's really what the body of Christ is missing.
That's right.
We're just so scattered, so controlled, so, you know, submitted, all these kind of things, and we're not bold and audacious, and we're not standing up against the kingdom of Satan. My goodness, how important is that?
Let me commend you on what you're doing in helping to be a voice in the kingdom of God, in making sure that the messages, the words, the teachings that is going forth through the platform that you are ministering on, as well as what we're doing in broadcasting also 24/7 worldwide, that God is using us to wake up first and foremost his people, And then from there, because judgment begins with the house of God first, and then once we're going through this process of being judged, coming to a place of unity, being unified as one body in the kingdom, now we can really affect the world. We can go out and really minister the word of God, preach the word of God, touch so many people, because now the body of Christ is coming together. And I want to commend you. Keep doing what you're doing. I would love to come back and be a guest on your platform, your show again. And then whenever you are in coming to Texas, please let me know, because I would make sure you come to the studio so I can do a live interview with you.
Hey, what an honor, Pastor. Let everybody know about some of your websites and how they can get in contact with you and support your ministry, and of course, your broadcasting channel.
Yes, sir. Kingdom Broadcasting Network is the network's channel. www.kbntv.tv. If you know about TBN, just think of KBN. KBNTV.tv is our main website, and you can go there and watch any of the past programs of any of our broadcasters, including myself, or watch what's being broadcast live by clicking watch live any time of the day. You can also, if you have a Android phone, you can go to the Google Play Store and download our app, KBN TV. If you have the Apple phone, we have a temporary download for those that have an Apple product, because we're still waiting for Apple to give us the final go ahead. And then we're working on many other platforms in terms of the mobility, because I believe that so many people is on the move and they're doing things on the go. We want to make sure that we have the mobile accesses available for people that is moving around, that they can catch anything that we're doing in broadcasting. So I want to thank you for allowing me to be here, to be a part of this time spent in discussing about the kingdom of God. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pastor Mitchell, for being with us today. For joining us today. We'll be right back after this short break. Oh, and actually, well, we're going to end right here. We're probably going to end right here because it's just such a glorious time we have in the kingdom. Time just disappears and we go into the eternal realm. Stay strong, everybody. Be blessed this day. And of course, stand with the King of Kings with your crown and rod of iron, so that Satan will tremble with fear in your presence. We thank you for joining us once again, and we will see you tomorrow, 5 a.m. sharp. God bless, Godspeed, and may His kingdom come.
Surely alive.